Father, we thank you today for your grace. We thank you for leading and directing all that's said, all that's done. We give you praise, the glory today. We thank you, God, for the spirit of thanksgiving. In all things, we give you thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning us. We thank you, Father, for the work that you have begun in us, and we believe the work that you have begun, you will continue to perform it. We give you praise and the glory, in Jesus' name. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
In
Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, last Sunday we were speaking about six keys to staying focused spiritually. And the first key that we mentioned was self-restraint or self-discipline. And we gave the example of Daniel, who was very much in control of his sensual appetites, and how God used his self-restraint not only for him but for the three Hebrew boys to cause them to be 10 times wiser than all of the other astrologers and magicians in the kingdom. There were men that had visions and had dreams and could interpret such the same, and for that reason it paid off for Daniel and the three Hebrew boys to live a self-disciplined life. Amen. So it's a big plus when you can control your physical appetite. Someone said that we have basically four appetites: appetite for hunger, appetite for food. How many like to eat? How many eat to live, or how many live to eat? Okay. The appetite of hunger is perhaps the strongest physical appetite that we have. Because the first thing that we do in the mornings, the first thing we want to do is what? Eat. That's the first thing that comes to our mind. Our coffee, breakfast, what we're going to cook today, and so forth and so on. All right, the second most potent appetite physically, of course, is your sexual appetite. It might not hold true in every case when you get old, 80, 90, 100 years old. I'm not sure how bad that is. But in the youth of life, and up to a certain age, sex is a major appetite. And it's one that we have to keep subservient to our spiritual appetite in order to not to lose control. The third strongest appetite is appetite for material things. We call it covetous appetite, greed. How many just like stuff? Anytime, I don't care whether you need it or not, if it's on sale, they'll get it. It's a good deal. That's why I am Brother Walter sometimes. It's a good deal. I went to a sale the other day. I said, man, this is a good deal. I like letters. That was before we had this water revelation. They had this big package of salad mix but by $4. I've been paying $2 by $3, just a little smaller. I said, man, this is a good deal. And I bought the whole thing, man. It was enough for 25 or 34. And about a week or so, that whole package is spoiled. After I got it, it didn't want it. And then we found out about the water when you testing. Washing your vegetables, when you're washing your vegetables, when you take water out of the tap, all that chlorine goes into your vegetables, and nothing is cleansed from the vegetables that you're trying to clean. All right, now the fourth appetite, naturally, that all of us have, might call it an appetite, but it's a spiritual appetite, as breaks various degrees with certain people. The appetite for God should be first. Appetite for God's spiritual things, that should be first. But whenever your appetite for spiritual things is not running the show, it's not first, if it's not first and foremost, if it's not stronger than the other appetites, you're going to have some serious problems in your flesh dealing with keeping yourself under control. So it seems like the appetite of hunger controls all of the others. And when you can control the appetite of hunger, it enhances your spiritual appetite, and it helps you to develop a lot quicker, and you can actually begin to see how your mind, in terms of being renewed, is going to escalate much faster than when you do not have any self-restraint. Sometimes it takes people 15 to 20 years to get nowhere in the Lord. And sometimes it takes people 10 years to get victory over cigarettes. And certain things, that takes a long time. And I have found out, whenever you can get people to live a self-restrained life and get control over their eating and just eat when they have to, just eat enough to sustain them, you can see that they have a whole lot more self-control. And normally they're not. I remember when I first got saved, I was a single gentleman. I was only 21 years old when I, you know, first started teaching school. You know, it was my first job away from home, about 40 miles from home. My home then was in Arkansas, and I wasn't married. I was courting Sister Hill. I was going with her. That's Donna Sampson and courting. I was just headed to court, and I went saved. Amen. So the temptations were strong. So I decided that I was going to get married, and which I did. After I got saved, in August, and I got married in December. I went on and got saved. Amen. I mean, I went on and got married after I got saved. I got saved in August. Okay. And I found out after taking my job that when you get saved, it doesn't mean that your carnal appetites just stop operating. Your lust, you know, and your want stuff, want to do stuff, and all of these feelings you have, that still keeps on going, right? All right, so you have to build your spirit up so that your spirit can come to the point where your spirit can say no to your what? Flesh. Right? So I tried fasting after I got saved, and that my first 3 or 4 months I wasn't saved, so I started working away from home. And I found out as I began to fast and pray, the less I had a desire, the less cravings I had to do things that were not consistent with God's will. So that was the thing that really revealed to me that if you can control and discipline yourself and just eat, or, you know, I was fasting then, and, you know, and when I fasted and prayed, it seems like I never had a desire, amen, to do anything that I wasn't supposed to do. And if I did have it, it just was a fleeting thought. I was able to restrain it and to bring it in line with the Word of God. It was easy for me to do. And also, I remember when I was doing that, I would have visions and dreams and all kind of things that would come to pass. So it seemed like by living a disciplined life, it really enhanced me in terms of exerting control over my physical body, as well as it made it easier for me to discern spiritual things and really get a greater revelation of God's will for me, amen, as a as a believer. Okay, so that was Daniel's mode of operation. And the children, well, the Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, those three Hebrew boys, they were 10 times stronger by eating vegetables than all of the other magicians and astrologers and all of these great men when they were eating the full-fledged meal. You know, the meals like we normally eat. The meats, how many know the meats are just something that we just can't hardly do without. Sometimes people don't think you've had a meal until you've had meat. And you will learn that meats are acid-forming and alkaline-destroying. And it really works. It sets the stage for all types of dreadful diseases to take hold in your physical body. I was listening to a DVD the other night. It was saying that whenever a person eats plant-based protein. Protein is meat. It can be any other vegetables and fruit, or proteins to certain lines. Also, there is soy, which is a plant-based protein, and you can get a whole lot of different proteins that's plant-based. But they did say that whenever your diet is comprised of plant-based protein, that it will stop the growth of cancer, or it will reverse it. Many times, cancer starts up in your body, and if you eat the right thing, it's reversed. If you keep on eating, you can retard the growth, or you can even turn it completely around. But if you eat meat, then it starts to revive. Meat stimulates the growth of cancer cells. Meat does, because it's acid forming. And that's the type of environment that cancer thrives in an acid-based environment. Okay, so if you notice that because Daniel was disciplined in that particular area, he paid off all through he was a diplomat. He worked for all of the kings. It was a total of 5 or 6 of them during his 80-some years of life. I think he spent 60 years in service with all the different kings. And he was always the favorite. He was always the top dog. He was always the first president. And he was always at the head of it, because all of them fell in love with Daniel because of his excellent spirit. And he always operated and performed without a flaw. Amen. He was just a perfect individual. If you want to find a person that would be a good example or a type of Christ, you always look at men like Joseph and you look at men like Daniel. Amen. Now, that was, he paid off all through his life. Bible says he prayed 3 times a day. How many feel the need to pray 3 times a day? Amen. He had his head on straight, right? Some people say, well, I just pray whenever I get to it. You just have, you know, but I think it's good to stop sometimes and just say, what, set aside some, what, time to what, pray. How many believe that's good to do that? Amen. Because sometimes when you just pray as you go, pray whatever you think about it, that's good too, but you need to set a habit, what, a certain time that you would give God some, what, quality time. In the morning. That's the reason why I recommend 4 o'clock in the morning, 4:30. No later than 5. I recommend that. Touch somebody and say, Pastor Hill recommends that. Pastor Hill recommends that. All right. So now I've already shared with you how you can get a good prayer meeting going just by using what? The words coming out of your mouth. You can just pick up your meditation book, whatever hits you, appeal to you, and I have some favorite things that I like to focus on certain times. I like to focus on God's faithfulness. And when I read over all of those incidents and cases and scriptures where God has been faithful all down through the ages, that really perks me up big time. God's faithfulness is a big thing. Now, if you ask me, you don't have that meditation book with that in it, but if you ask me, for that, I can give you probably 10 to 12 pages, examples of faithfulness, and God promises concerning his faithfulness. It is just tremendous. That always gets me going. If you ask for it, if you desire, just ask for it. All I have to do is run it off, and I can put it into your hand. But there are many scriptures, scriptures that deal with God's, let me see. Another area is what you have in your possession. If you don't have it, just ask for it. Speaking God's word out aloud. The importance of having whatever God promises you, whatever God's will is for you, to begin to speak that out aloud. I mean, out aloud so you can hear it. Amen. Speaking God's word out aloud is nothing like it. Amen. Out quietly. You don't have to wake everybody up.